jeez.
You will.
Jerry Jones. Something.
This may have been a bad idea.
I suppose we'll find out.
This way.
That was a Hebridean black.
I'm guessing the egg we have belongs to that dragon.
I don't think she knew they had her egg. She wouldn't have left without it.
What now? She didn't exactly leave us a calling card.
I don't know. Nothing about this day was expected. Not the goblins, and definitely not the fighting ring. The last thing I planned on was a dragon egg. And the poachers saw us, which cannot be good.
Since the dragon we freed flew off, does that mean we get to keep the egg?
I'd much rather we have it than the poachers, at least for now. But I don't think we should keep it indefinitely. It'll be hard hiding something like this from Professor Weasley for long.
Should we expect trouble from the poachers, given the trouble we just caused?
It'd be foolish not to expect it. They're not a forgiving lot. I'm sorry to say that you likely have a larger target on your back now because of what we just did.
We aren't helping ourselves standing here. Let's get to safety. We can sort this out later.
You're right. If there's anything the poachers are good at, it's tracking their prey. And right now, we're it. Be careful, won't you? I shall see you back at the castle.
You'll never believe what I've learned.
What did you discover in the spellbook we found in the scriptorium?
Salazar Slytherin's spellbook was a little difficult to interpret, but fascinating. Evidently, he encouraged teaching dark magic at Hogwarts. Neither the Imperius Curse nor the Killing Curse was unforgivable during his time. He believed students should be prepared to use dark magic when necessary, not to fear it. That's why we had to use Crucio to gain access to the scriptorium. He didn't want his knowledge shared with anyone who was afraid of the power of dark magic.
It was hard to do, but casting Crucio was our only option.
And I'm glad we did it, because in the spellbook I also found something else. references to a lost relic, which, from what I can tell, grants the holder the power to reverse dark magic curses.
And you think this relic might be able to save Anne?
Precisely. I plan to search for this relic, but I don't think we should tell anyone. Especially Ominous. He wouldn't understand.
I see no reason to involve Ominous.
I'm glad you agree. When I know more, I shall send an owl. And don't feel sorry for Ominous. Keeping this to ourselves for now is for his own good.
I'll decide what's for my own good.
Ominous, we were just about to get some air. Care to join?
You're a liar, Sebastian. I heard everything. You swore you'd never engage in anything to do with dark magic again.
No, I didn't. I said I understood you wanting that. I'd never swear to give up on finding a cure for Anne.
You don't know when to stop, do you?
I know when not to stop. Leave this alone, Ominous. I'll be on my way.
I am not letting this go.
Ominous, Sebastian meant well.
I know what I heard. You knew I wouldn't agree with this. Going after that relic is not a good idea. Sebastian doesn't even realize it, but he's as irresponsible and reckless now as his parents were years ago. It's why they died.
I knew his parents died, but I never heard what happened.
Mr. and Mrs. Sallow were professors. Spent nearly every waking moment in the cellar library. Noses buried in books. Anne and Sebastian were upstairs when it happened. They heard a sudden crash and ran downstairs, but it was too late. Their parents had crumpled to the floor. A defect with the lamp in the cellar caused the room to fill with an undetectable toxin. Sebastian and Anne were helpless. They had no magic yet.
What a horrible story.
It is. That's why I can't understand Sebastian's recklessness. I've practically lost Anne. I cannot lose Sebastian, too. Please avoid anything to do with that spellbook.
Some references Sebastian mentioned in the book do worry me.
I'm glad you understand. I hope Sebastian pursues this no further. But if you think he might, please let me know. It would mean a lot.
Can I neutral mount it? I gotta swim. Seems like it's. Looks like I can go back to the room of requirement to check on the breeding. So what they're gonna tell me.
Grey lady.
Questioner.
I'd say hello, but she doesn't seem particularly social.
Form my uniform.
Rebellion.
Professor Weasley asked me to find. Should be around here somewhere.
Rebellion.
Looking for the book Intermediate Transfiguration.
Nope. What are the odds? She has the book.
Professor Weasley asked me to, get something from that book. May I have it?
Did she now? I'll give you this book if you humor me by answering a few questions from my quiz.
Quiz?
Some people call bits of knowledge trivia. I would argue that no knowledge is trivial. Hence, I have created a small quiz, just for fun, focusing mainly on the lore of the Wizarding World. None of the other students will try it, no matter how many times I ask. They all say they have enough with schoolwork. Oh, they don't value knowledge the way I do. Surely you're interested. I'll even start you off with a few of my easiest questions.
A quiz sounds like fun.
Splendid! Just a few questions, and then I'll hand over this book. Let us begin. Before the invention of the Golden Snitch, which magical creature was used in a game of Quidditch?
Great. Not that familiar with the Wizarding World. Not so familiar with the lore.
The snake bird?
No. Incorrect. The answer was the Golden Snidget. The Snidget was first introduced to Quidditch in 1269 by a wizard named Barbarous Bragg. Sadly, they're thought to be extinct. Next question. Which potion is commonly referred to as liquid luck?
Great. Again, I don't know. Felix Felicis, Alianzia Drought, the Pepper Potion. This one, I don't know.
Felix Felicis.
Well done! Since it makes the drinker temporarily lucky, Felix Felicis is a banned substance in all organized competitions. The tale of the three brothers involves which magical artifacts?
It's one correct. I'm just going by guesses. I guess I could just look up the answers somewhere. Wow. Oops.
The Founder's Relics.
No. The answer was the Deathly Hallows. According to Beedle the Bard, the Deathly Hallows consists of the Elder Wand, the Resurrection Stone, and the Cloak of Invisibility. Which ball in Quidditch is the largest?
The Quaffle.
That's right. When a chaser throws the Quaffle through one of three hoops in a Quidditch match, their team is awarded 10 points. True or false? Polyjuice Potion allows the drinker to change species.
True.
Actually, the answer was false. While Polyjuice Potion can be used to change things such as age or race, it cannot be used to change species. Well, I suppose this has gone on long enough. I'll put the book back on the pedestal now. If you're inclined to test your knowledge again, I have plenty more questions I could ask you. And I won't be giving you any more easy questions either. The next ones will be more difficult.
I'm sorry. I don't have time for a quiz at the moment.
Let me know if you change your mind. I put the book back on the pedestal for you.
Revelio ought to make quick work of this.
Terrible at that. Look on the intermediate transfiguration. This book is designed to help guide the student who wishes to pursue more complicated types of transfiguration. Professor Weasley often recommends it to our advanced students as a bit of light reading.
Professor Weasley's tasks are complete. I should attend transfiguration.
Let's see.
My mother would like to speak with me. I believe she has learned about some of what we've been up to. I'm hoping she may be easier on me if you are there.
Can we meet at the Three Broomsticks? It may finally be safe since we've rescued the dragon from Horntail Hall.
This one right here. The page right there. freed the offspring. Where's the offspring? Oh, there's the baby. There's the baby. That's actually activated the breed thing again.
Hello, Deke. You'll be pleased to know that a little Thestral was born.
How wonderful to have more Thestrals in our world. Such misunderstood beasts.
I'm sorry that we can both see Thestrals, Deke.
Deke is privileged to see such majestic beasts, but sometimes wishes Deke couldn't. Deke is to blame.
What do you mean, to blame?
Years ago, Deke's master ordered Deke to help him capture a phoenix, the rarest of all beasts, that master had spotted high on a cliff. The phoenix was the most beautiful beast Deke had ever seen. Deke begged master to leave her be. When Deke hesitated to climb up the cliff as ordered, Deke had to punish himself. As Deke punished himself, Master grew angrier and angrier, and in his frustration cast at the regal bird. Deke suspects the phoenix was protecting eggs when it swooped down in fear and fury. Before Deke could reach him, Master fell from the cliff. Deke stayed on that cliffside for days, punishing himself, before Tobbs found him.
What a horrible tale, Deke. I'm so sorry.
Deke has only told Professor Weasley that story. And now yourself. Deke often wonders what became of that phoenix. Deke feels fortunate to be at Hogwarts now, helping you rescue beasts. Perhaps Deke can make amends for what came before.
Settle down, settle down. Transfiguration, as you may be weary of hearing me say, is an exact science that can take a lifetime to master. But we needn't be daunted. Almost anything can be transformed if you can just perceive the potential within it. As I see in all of you, tremendous witches and wizards, every one of you. Or it could just be my eyesight. Now, you all know what to do. beautifully done.
This might as well be the perfect stopping point, because I think I might just want to stop right here for now and continue another time as usual. Alright then.
Later.
You wanted to discuss my progress so far this term, Professor.
I did. You seem to have had no trouble in getting up to speed, and frankly, excelling in your schoolwork this year.
Thank you, Professor. The extra assignments have been helpful.
As I suspected they would be. Now, it seems you've been making good use of the opportunities presented by your field guide. Of course, the guide isn't the only measure of success. I've heard that you can brew an impressive Edurus potion. Hopefully you won't need it anytime soon, but it is a valuable potion to have when it is needed.
Thank you, Professor.
I will say I'm especially impressed with all you've accomplished in light of the rumors of your extracurricular activities. Was your extended conversation with Mr. Ollivander after you'd obtained your wand, or subsequent search of the Owlery, connected in any way to Professor Fig?
Not at all. I enjoy talking to Mr. Ollivander. I'm fascinated by a wand lore, and I'd never visited the Owlery. Bit of a mess.
I see. I admire your penchant for learning, but do remember that your classwork and field guide are designed to educate you thoroughly. It'll be the end of the year in no time, and you'll want to be well prepared for your OWLs. I'll provide a final assessment at that time to ensure that you're ready for your exams. Until then, well done. You are dismissed. If you wish to practice the spell you just learned, the training dummy is available. Glad to see you were paying close attention to my demonstration of the transformation spell.
Since our visit to Feldcroft, something dawned on me about the triptych. Meet me at the Overlook, just north of the Forbidden Forest, and I'll explain.
My plan with the helmet failed.
I remember Armeet mentioning something about gobbledygook.
So frustrating. You wanted to speak with me, Mother?
I had hoped to speak with you alone, Natsai.
Your message mentioned your concern about an unusual creature that was spotted in the woods near Hogsmeade. That could have been anything.
You know what it was, Natsai.
I am allowed to leave the castle. I am always careful, Mother.
Careful? Officer Singer disagrees. She sent me an owl telling me that you have been trying to collect evidence of some kind against dark wizards. She berated me for not keeping a closer eye on you, and she is right. I do not want you visiting Hogsmeade for the near future.
But Mother!
My little gazelle, you are well-intentioned, but you must not meddle in the affairs of dangerous people.
If someone had meddled in Matabeleland, Father would still be with us.
I must get to class. Perhaps your friend can get you to listen to reason.
So frustrating. She never listens to me.
She called you her little gazelle. Is that a term of endearment where you're from?
It is specific to me. I am the unusual creature in Hogsmeade she mentioned. Self-transfiguration is not taught at Hogwarts, so I am gently discouraged from practicing it. However, I am an animagus, and it is in my gazelle form that I have been able to wander the Highlands rather freely until now, much to my mother's chagrin. That is how I managed to spy on Rookwood and Harlow.
Were you born an animagus, or did you learn to become one?
Animagi are not born. The process is quite elaborate. It involves holding a mandrake leaf in one's mouth for an entire month, then placing the leaf in a crystal phial so that it is imbued with moonlight, then adding one of your own hairs. And that is just the beginning. Self-transfiguration is common among students at Wagadu, but Professor Weasley considers it much too dangerous to teach at Hogwarts.
Can you choose what form your animagus will take?
Oh no. A person's animagus form is determined by their personality. My mother is convinced that my form is a gazelle because I adapt well to any situation. I believe it is because I can sense danger and keep my wits about me.
How does it feel to transform into an animal?
Well, the first time, it can be a bit unnerving. I felt a kind of searing pain and a strong double heartbeat. But it gets easier the more you do it. I no longer feel any pain, and I must say, I find a sense of comfort in the double heartbeat. And I love being able to view the world from a different perspective.
Now the nickname makes sense. What an extraordinary ability to have.
It is. I love transforming, but Mother is less enthusiastic about it. She says that no creature, especially one as rare as a gazelle, should be bounding about where poaching has become so prevalent. She claims that she has foreseen tragedy befall me in my gazelle form. But she has used her sight to control me too many times. I no longer believe it.
We're making good progress. We can't quit now.
I agree. I have never considered quitting, even for a moment. You could have fled the moment you discovered that Rookwood, Harlow, and Randrock were after you, but you did not. I choose to act as you have. I must deal with Rookwood and Harlow, not hide from them. My mother cannot know where I am all the time. Thank you for being here during that rather awkward conversation.
Hello there. Was there something you needed?
Hello. I was wondering if you would be interested in having your own shop and a house elf to help you with it. Penny's the name. Penny's mistress is selling this shop. And Penny is most eager to start working with the new owner. It might surprise you to know that Penny can sell practically anything.
Oh. It would be wonderful to have a place to sell things, and someone to help me.
You'll be able to give Penny almost anything that you want to sell. It will be no work at all for you once the shop is up and running. If you want the shop, and Penny hopes that you do, you should talk to Penny's mistress as soon as you can. Her name is Cassandra Mason.
Why is your mistress selling the shop, and you?
Penny cannot be certain, as Mistress Mason so rarely confides in her. However, she repeatedly mentions how tired she has become of trying to let the shop. She has had rotten bad luck with the last few tenants.
Are you all right? Are you holding your breath?
Penny's fine. Sometimes Penny simply needs to remind herself to stop talking.
What kind of things would I be able to sell in the shop?
All kinds. Anything from essence of Dittany to mooncalf fur. If a buyer exists for something, then Penny can sell it and get the best price. Just ask Mistress Mason.
premises in such disarray?
Oh, the previous tenants were not able to manage very well. They seem to have given up rather quickly. Penny is perfectly capable of helping clean and repair, so the shop will be ready for business in no time.
How is it you're so good at selling? Seems unusual for a house elf.
Oh, before he died, Penny's previous owner, Master Mason, trusted her to do all sorts of things to help him with his shop. Penny supposes it is a bit unusual for a house elf to possess such skill, but Master Mason commanded it, and Penny was happy to oblige. Master Mason was a wonderful master.
All right. I shall go and find Madame Mason.
Oh, this is splendid news indeed. You won't be sorry. You can find Mistress Mason at her home on the north edge of the village. Penny does hope she gets to work with you.
Hello, Madame Mason. I understand you have a shop to sell.
Why, yes. Yes, I do. Are you interested?
Perhaps. It depends upon your terms.
I think you will find my terms quite generous. But, and do please forgive me for asking, don't you think you might be a tad young to own a shop?
I have a knack for this sort of thing, if I do say so myself. If I can meet your terms, I hope that you'll sell to me.
Well, I reckon you have the confidence needed for such a venture. And of course you'll have Penny to help you. That elf could sell tea to a troll. I assume she told you she comes with the place.
She did indeed.
I like you. Tell you what, I shall sell you the space for an exceedingly fair price. I think you might just be shrewd enough to make a go of it.
An exceedingly fair price for a shop and an elf. What's the catch?
Huh? You are wise to be wary in business dealings. No catch, really. I simply ask that you allow me to do you the favour of buying the shop back. At a discount, of course, should your efforts fail. The last thing we need here in Hogsmeade is for one bad apple to spoil the barrel, if you get my meaning.
Yes. An unsuccessful shop would be bad for nearby businesses, I'd imagine.
Quick one, you are. Do we have a deal?
What precisely do you mean, should my efforts fail?
Honestly, I only mean that if for some reason you're unable to keep the shop going, I could help you cut your losses. That's all. But, as you've implied, the odds of that happening are remote.
The shop seems to be in an ideal location. Why has no one purchased it yet?
It is indeed. But I've just decided to sell. I've grown weary of being a landlady. My late husband was the one with a passion for shopkeeping and business in general. You'd be wise to take advantage of this opportunity before the offers start rolling in.
It looks to be rather a mess. Why haven't other tenants been able to make a go of it there?
As you've no doubt considered, running a shop is not as simple as those less savvy might think. The new owner, however, will have something that previous tenants did not. The benefit of Penny's particular prowess. Her assistance will make all the difference, I should think, in both getting the shop ready for business and ensuring its success.
It does sound intriguing, but I need to consider my finances first. I'll come and find you if I'm interested.
Very well, but I won't be able to keep the shop available for too long. If you do want the shop, I'd advise you to return to me as soon as possible. Hello again. You know, the shop won't be available forever. Penny's...
So much I have.
change of pace from our last outing.
Don't remind me. The thought of that tent still makes my blood boil. I've been thinking about those poor dragons in the fighting ring. The collars they were wearing, they appeared to be goblin silver. I think a collar is precisely what we found at that poacher camp. I've never known poachers to use anything like that before.
The dragon that attacked my carriage was wearing a collar, and Professor Fig was genuinely baffled by its behavior.
That attack always did strike me as a little strange, seemingly coming out of nowhere. Surely you aren't suggesting that the collars somehow control the poor creatures?
Exactly.
Merlin, I don't think the dragon we set free was wearing a collar, but we should check. And if we can find her, we can return her egg.
That's a good idea. We need to see this through.
I'll start looking into it right away. There was something else that I wanted to discuss with you. I didn't want to press it before. It seems I may have caused you more trouble with Victor Rookwood. Why is he after you?
Rookwood is working with Ranrok, and Ranrok is after something I found at Gringotts. Fig had a portkey that led us there after the dragon attack. It's a bit of a long story, and Fig had asked that I not speak of it yet.
Goodness. Well, that certainly helps to shed light on what we saw at the tent. Don't worry, I'll guard your secret as if it were my own. I shan't press for more details. In fact, I should probably be going. I'd like to track that dragon down as soon as I can. I'll let you know when I have news of her location.
Hello there.
Hello, Almeet. Do I recall you saying that you speak gobbledygook?
I did. I mean, I do. Speak it. Is this to do with the goblin I saw you with in Hogsmeade?
It is. His name is Lodgok. We could use your help with something. He's waiting for me near a goblin mine. Would you be willing to help?
Of course. How exciting. I mean, well, might this be dangerous?
I think he simply wants to show me something that involves gobbledygook. If it helps, he's a friend of Serona's.
Good to hear. Good to hear. If Serona trusts him, then I feel much better.
You said you know gobbledygook, but how well?
I've been reading it for as long as I've been reading English. My parents have an extensive library. Once I grew bored with the classics, I devoured goblin writings. I'd tell you some titles, but you wouldn't understand them.
Have you ever spoken directly to a goblin?
Unbelievably, no. I'm so looking forward to it. Actually conversing in gobbledygook with a native speaker. Cannot wait to confirm subtle bits of pronunciation and tone that may have eluded me, being self-taught and all.
Lodgok is waiting. Shall we go?
Of course. I just want to check the pronunciation of a couple of key terms first. So I will meet you there.
Revelio.
Astronomy telescope. This telescope is the finest stargazing instrument of its kind. Perfect for viewing the moon and the stars and anything else one might find in the night sky.
Anne is getting worse. If there is any chance that the relic from Slytherin's spellbook can help her, I must find it. I'm requesting your help. Meet me outside of Feldcroft, near the catacomb.
A friend who speaks gobbledygook is meeting us. Before he arrives, perhaps you could tell me why we're here?
Of course. Unfortunately, presenting Ranrok with the helmet of Urtgot did not have the effect I'd hoped. Because he knew the details surrounding its plunder, he presumed I'd had help from a witch or wizard in retrieving it.
How else did he expect goblin kind to get the helmet back? Seems he has no interest in making amends with you.
I'm afraid we do not have the luxury of rational expectation when it comes to Ranrok. Damn Bragbor and his blasted journals.
Bragbor?
An ancestor of Ranrok's, renowned metal worker. If we are to work together, I suppose I must tell you more. Not long ago, Ranrok sent me to collect a recently unearthed set of Bragbor's journals. They describe repositories that Bragbor had been commissioned to build for a group of witches and wizards.
What do you mean, repositories?
Large, magically fortified receptacles crafted from goblin metal. Ranrok recruited others to help me locate the repositories. We were to search anywhere that was connected to five names mentioned in the journals. Rackham, Fitzgerald, Bakar, Morganock, and Rookwood.
Rookwood Castle.
That is where we began our search.
Why does Ranrok care so much about these repositories?
He cares about what they contain. For centuries, wizards have refused to share their magical knowledge with goblins. Your kind will not even let us carry wands. Thus, many goblins, myself included, have spent our lives mistrusting wizard kind. Ranrok was convinced that the repositories contained a magical power that wizards wanted to keep for themselves. He was, is, determined to take it for goblin kind. But he's...
Here comes my friend Armeet. Probably best to continue our conversation later.
Greetings, Lord Gok. It is an honor, sir.
You speak gobbledygook.
Oh, Bagalio.
Enough. Please do not tell me that was meant to be gobbledygook.
Yes. Perhaps my pronunciation was a bit off. I imagine certain dialects differ.
Pronunciation is not the issue. I barely recognize that as language. I trust you can read gobbledygook better than you can speak it?
I can, Sir Lord Gok.
Just Lord Gok. Thankfully, we only need someone who can decipher written plans, since I cannot join you in the mine.
What written plans? And why can't you come with us?
We need some idea of what Ranrok knows or is plotting. I suspect a careless loyalist may have left plans behind. And I'm unable to join you because I cannot risk anyone reporting my presence to Ranrok. All you need to do is not be seen. Either by the eye above the enchanted door, or a loitering loyalist.
What else should we know about the enchanted door?
The door will not open while the eye can see you. You and your friend must be invisible to it to gain access. From what I know of wizard magic, that shouldn't be too difficult to achieve.
Armeet and I can do this.
I will await your return. I shall see you soon.
The door is looking at us.
About. You'll see.
To treat it like a chest.
Books so rarely prepare one for reality. A real goblin mine. It's even grander than I had expected. I cannot believe I met a goblin.
Let's just learn what we can and get out.
Look at this lift. Impressive workmanship for so simple a device.
Impressive workmanship aside, it's the only way forward.
These machines operate on steam. Interesting.
Confringo!
You can't believe we're inside a real goblin mine. About mines like this, but seeing one is something else altogether.
Accio. Goblin Tune, you need to stay close to me. I've dealt with worse enemies than these.
Entirely stealth.
Right, being watched by a door.
Books I read during the summer holidays.
Let's take a look around, Armit. See if we can find any plans.